Oh, hi. Nice to see you. Welcome back to the Game Design Seminar. This is episode 2 called Three Questions. And this is where we really get into the meat of actual game design. We've talked a little bit about high concept, but here's where we really start talking about the decisions that influence the rest of your game. I use what's commonly now called Jared's Big Three Questions to give me kind of a compass. Any creative endeavor is like walking through a forest, and if you don't have a compass, you get lost pretty easily, especially when you're trying to paint the trees. So using Jared's Three Questions, we'll set a paradigm for how we're actually going to design the game. And those three big questions, well, let's let Jared describe them.
The three questions are, number one, what is your game about? Number two, how is your game about that? And number three, how does your game reward or encourage that behavior? That's it.
Thanks, Jared. So, the first question, what is your game about? This really sets the tone for everything. If your game is about love, then you should have mechanics that reflect that. If your game is about violence, then you should have mechanics that reflect that. All too often in the seminar, when Jared and I are talking to people and they say, for example, one guy said, my game is about a post-apocalyptic future. And we said, no, that's where your game takes place, but that's not what your game is about. Another guy said, my game is about a George Orwell-like totalitarian state. And we said, no, that's not what your game is about. That's where your game takes place. These kinds of things are typical in designing games. People get distracted by the setting, thinking that it's the theme, and it's not. For the post-apocalyptic guy, let's see if I can say that big word, it was really about hope. That's what his game was about hope versus despair. And so we asked him, does your game have a hope versus despair mechanic? And he said, no. And I said, well, why not? Same thing with the Orwellian guy. When we really pushed him, we found out that his game was about control. And he wanted his game to be about what it's like to be in control. So you played 1984 as if you were Big Brother, and the game is about competing Big Brother organizations trying to control the culture and what you're willing to do to keep that control. And that's really hot. That's what his game's about. For Houses of the Blooded, my game is about tragedy. All too often in role-playing games, because of the way that experience point memes work, characters only get better. Because they're getting more experience points, their skills get better, their attributes get better, their magic items get better, they get stronger. A lot of games really break down to, I kill the monster to take its stuff, to get bigger treasure, to kill bigger monsters, to kill bigger monsters, to get bigger treasure, to kill bigger monsters, and on and on and on like that. But for Houses, I wanted it to be a game about tragedy. So in the game, well, I'll pause there because that really goes into the second question, which is, how does your game do that? In Houses, almost everything on your character sheet is both a blessing and a curse. There's almost nothing on the character sheet that, if it gives you a bonus, it also provides for you some kind of weakness. So every character has an inbuilt Achilles flaw, at least one. Most of them have two or three. So everything in the game, every benefit that you achieve in the game, is also a hindrance that can be taken advantage of by enemies. And that was my first big step. That was my first, answering that question was my first big clue how to make the rest of the game. And then finally, Jared's third question, which is, well, what behaviors does that reward and punish? And so I had to come up with a way to reward players, a mechanic that would reward players. And that eventually became what are known as style points. In the game, I want players acting appropriately to the theme of tragedy. So when you do, when you make bad decisions, when you expose a weakness, when you otherwise show how fragile your character really is, the Game Master rewards you with style points. And style points are really the engine of the game. You can't do any of the big effects without a style point. You have to spend style points in order to get big effects. And in order to get style points, you have to show your weakness. So it creates a dichotomy in the game where the players have to show weakness in order to be cool. And in order to be cool, they have to show weakness. So from that point of view, remembering the theme that we want to create a game that's more like Elric than Conan, you have to create a character that is inherently flawed, that is inherently tragic. Now, I like to add a fourth question onto Jared's big three questions, which is, how do you make that fun? For me, I think a lot of game designers overlook this. They'll overlook this really crucial fourth question. For me, the question became, how do you make tragedy fun? And in Houses of the Blooded, the way that I do it is by avoiding the whiff factor. Now, the whiff factor is something familiar to some gamers. Essentially, it's a way of expressing that feeling you get, that of swinging for the, you know, swinging for the cheap seats, and you hear that whiff of the bat go by as it misses the ball. In other words, you have this really great, important action that your character is about to undertake in the game, and it's just crucial, and it's going to be so cool when you succeed and you roll a 2. That little arbitrary piece of plastic just doesn't even care about your character's success or failure, or the story, or anything, or your character. Just doesn't care. So how do you avoid the whiff factor? How do you make that moment of crucial failure fun? And the answer is something else I learned from Jared, which is you let the players determine their own failure. In most role-playing games, when you roll dice, you roll to see whether your character succeeds or fails. And the Game Master tells you how your character succeeds or fails. If you succeed in the roll, your character succeeds. If you fail in the roll, your character fails. In Houses, it works a little bit differently. In Houses, the target number is a standard 10. It's almost always 10. And you roll a bunch of six-sided dice to see if you roll higher than 10. If you roll 10 or higher, you get to say how your character succeeds or fails. So you control the triumph or tragedy of your character. If you fail on the roll, if you roll 9 or less, then the Game Master says how your character succeeds or fails. So he controls your character's destiny. So that's what it really comes down to in Houses, is who has what we call privilege. Who can say whether the character succeeds or fails, and how it happens. So again, it's not about the dice telling you whether you succeed or fail. The dice tell you who gets to say whether your character succeeds or fails. So when that big moment comes where you want your character to fail, it's in your hands, not in some arbitrary piece of plastic that doesn't care. And that's how you make tragedy fun. You put it in the hands of the players.